Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church in Springfield, Ohio. This evening is our Christmas Eve candlelight service. We are located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Phone number is 937-323-7508. Join us for Sunday worship service at 8 a.m. and 10:30 a.m. and Wednesday evening services in the chapel at 6:30 p.m.
Thank you.
heard our handbell choir playing.
By what you have done, and by your God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen.
Amen.
Let us now begin our celebration with the singing of Come All You Faithful, hymn number 283, in the back of your red book, hymn number 283. Let us pray. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that here on earth we may walk in the light of Jesus' presence, and in the last day awake to the brightness of his glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
salvation through God, training us to renounce impiety and worldly pleasures, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly. While we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, He it is who gave Himself for us, that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for Himself people of His own, who are zealous for good deeds. The Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
come come to the manger and we see him and we worship him and praise him, we then go back to our normal vocation. We don't change our life just because we don't have Jesus Christ. Just because now we have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ does not mean we just totally forget our past life and start going around preaching unless it's been called to. But very few people, upon having a relationship with Jesus Christ, are called to change the life they live. Missionaries, evangelists, yes, they're called to change their lives. Clergy, they're called to change their lives and called to move to different places. But for the majority of Christians, when you encounter Jesus, he wants you to go back where you were. Back to that job. Back to that neighborhood. Back to your family and friends. And use those opportunities to share with them the good news of the gospel. But some people think that in order to show that they have now come upon a relationship with Jesus, that it means they have to change their lives dramatically. You remember that old story I told you some years ago about the guy who was a farmer and he was out in his field plowing, preparing to plant his spring crop. And as he was plowing, he looked up in the sky and he saw the letters PC. So immediately he thought, that's a sign from the Lord. He's telling me to preach Christ. So he left his mule and he left his plow and went home and picked up his King James Bible with all the ribbons hanging out of it and started preaching Christ all over the county. He had no luck whatsoever. So he went into the next county, preaching Christ wherever he could. Again, he had no luck. So he went to the third county, preaching, but no luck. So one night, all distraught and confused, he got down on his knees and he says, Lord, he says, I don't understand what's going on. I said, that day in the field, you gave me that sign, PC, preach Christ. He said, I've been preaching Christ throughout three counties now, and I haven't had one convert or started one church. The Lord answered back home, my son, you totally misunderstood my message. I wasn't telling you to preach Christ. I was telling you to plant corn. From what we read tonight in the shepherds, they're called to go back to where they were. They were called to change their life in one aspect, as we will see in a moment. But they were not called to now quit being the shepherd, quit watching the sheep, and go off and go all over the Middle East talking about this baby who was born that they had been able to see. And so our reaction to Christmas is after we experience the joy of coming face to face with the baby Jesus, coming face to face with our Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we then return to where we are to witness to others, to let them know the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we look at the early church, what do we see? We see that most Christians spread the good news by one-on-one conversations with their friends and neighbors. There were those that were called to preach. There were those that were called to be leaders in the new church. True, but not the majority. When you compare 3,000 converts to Christianity on that first Pentecost, we don't read of one of them becoming a pastor or an elder or becoming an evangelist and following St. Peter or St. Paul or any of the other apostles. They spread the good news one-on-one. And so our reaction to Christmas should be that gives us that reminder that we are to be Christ's witness one-on-one with those we meet. The second reaction should be we should have a new attitude. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God. The word glorifying means honor. They returned, they went back to where they were, esteeming and honoring God. The word praise means descending to God. Now, if you're familiar with shepherds in the days of Jesus' birth, you're familiar with the fact that these were hard men who lived hard lives. Closest thing to compare them to would be the cowboys driving cattle from a field up to a railhead in our own history of the West, going on this cattle trail and cattle drive and all that they had to put up with, droughts and floods and stampedes and rustlers and even at times by Native Americans, depending on where they were. The shepherds had to guard their sheep against thieves. They had to guard their sheep against lions, against bears, against wolves. So it wasn't a job for someone who was timid. And because of they had to be in the fields for long hours, they couldn't abide by all the rules and regulations of Judaism. Now many scholars think that these sheep and these shepherds were the sheep that were owned by the temple, the high priest, that were then taken to the temple and sold for sacrifices to the pilgrims when they came on those special holidays. Those sheep sellers that we read when Jesus becomes a dog drives out of the temple for that fact, for selling the sheep. So many believe that these were then shepherds employed by the temple. And yet, they were despised by the high priest and the Levites and the other priests because they couldn't abide by all the rules and regulations that Judaism demanded. They couldn't wash their hands every time they were supposed to. They couldn't have their clothing in the proper manner every time they were supposed to. They couldn't observe every rule and regulation because of being out in the field. And so it is safe to say that many of these shepherds really didn't make God a real high priority. They were kind of like a lot of people today who acknowledge the fact that there's God, who might even acknowledge the fact that there's an afterlife, who might even acknowledge Jesus Christ, but because you're so busy in your secular life, you don't really give much attention to God or to Jesus Christ. You don't really take time to pray every day. You don't take time to read from the Bible every day. You don't take time to go to worship and be part of a community of faith because God's just not that big of a priority. Your job's your priority. Getting ahead's your priority. Paying the mortgage is a priority. Paying the car payment's a priority. Saving for your college, your school, your kids' college education is a priority. And so a lot of people can identify with these shepherds. But now, after seeing the baby Jesus, as they return to where they were, their whole attitude toward God changes. They now esteem him. They now honor him. They now sing praises to him. That's why Luke does not leave out this important fact. This changed their whole attitude. And because it changed their attitude towards God, that means it then changed their attitude toward people. It changed their attitude toward one another. It changed their attitude towards those whom they came in contact with. It changed their attitude toward the priest and those who employed them. Because they could not be the same after having had an appearance with the Lord Jesus Christ. They just could not be the same after being told. The very first ones to be told. Not the priest. Not the king. Not the court. Not the Roman procurator. The very first people told of Jesus' birth are shepherds. And they return to where they were with this whole new attitude, just like we should have a whole new attitude confront the babe of Bethlehem. Now we should have a whole new attitude toward God, a whole attitude toward the Lord Jesus Christ, a whole new attitude toward one another. Because throughout your life, you're going to find times when you need the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to have times when everything is falling apart all around you, where everything just comes seem important now. You may be indifferent now, you may be bored now, but as you grow older, you will realize more and more how thankful you should be for the gift of that baby born in Bethlehem that first Christmas. He came, as the angels announced, as a Savior for all people. To forgive us of sin, to pay the debt of sin that we owe, to give us victory over death and the devil, to enable us to face death with confidence, not in fear, to enable us to face the difficulties of life in confidence, not cowering into the terrified. No matter what inappropriate or incorrect statements sometimes organized religion makes, the reality of Christmas is, in the words of that angel when he said, "For you, this day is born in the city of David, for all people, a Savior who is Christ." Didn't matter, rich, poor, smart or dumb, highly educated, no education, red, yellow, black, white, striped, polka dot, whatever, Christ died for you. Christ came for you. Christ loves you. So we return to where we are to witness to this wonderful love, with a new attitude toward God, a new attitude toward Jesus Christ, that new attitude toward life. And then we see from the shepherds that by encountering the baby Jesus, now they have a new motivation in life. The shepherds were businessmen. The shepherds knew the market price. The shepherds knew when to raise or lower the price of their sheep. They knew when someone was trying to pull the wool over their eyes. And so they were motivated by profit until they met the baby Jesus. Suddenly, profit and loss didn't seem so important anymore. Whether or not they pulled a deal over on somebody now seemed as an embarrassment and not as something to chuckle at. Their motivation was to be God's servant. Their motivation was to change their life in a way that would be pleasing to God. Their motivation was to show by their actions the appreciation that God had chosen them to be the first to see the Savior of the world. The first outside of the stable itself. They were the first to know. Even before the great magi from the east, with all their education and all their wealth, was those lowly shepherds. So the reaction was have a new attitude and a new motivation to love. And we see that happen when we allow Christ to be in our heart, when we allow Christ to be in our mind, when we allow Christ to truly be Lord of our life, we have a new motivation. We've seen it throughout the history of the church. St. Peter went from being a big mouth bragger who always failed when confronted with opposition, changed from that to being the leader of the early church and a great proclaimer of the gospel. We see St. Paul's motivation change from being Saul, the persecutor of the church, to being Paul the apostle, the greatest missionary and church founder, starter, grower, whatever term you want to use, the church has ever known. We see it in John Newton, the former slaver, captain of slave ships, who when confronted with the Lord Jesus Christ and coming face to face with the Lord Jesus Christ was motivated to change to end slavery in England, pass a law so that slavery was outlawed. He became an Anglican clergyman and wrote one of our most beloved hymns for all time, Amazing.
and everything. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Thank you. Nourish us with these gifts that we might further grow these signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather this table in our community and our own individual congregation. You invited and encouraged to come forth with us this night as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 7 in the worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It's time to give
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Christ, the Son of Mary, the Son of God, is born this night. God's Word has been made flesh among us. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in a land of deep darkness, on them a light has shined. You, O Lord, have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He is also called Emmanuel, for in him God is with us.
Thank you.
as God comes among us, the Christian's true light. Let us pray. Eternal God, this holy night is radiant with the brilliance of your one true light. May that light illumine our hearts and shine in our words and deeds. May the hope, the peace, the joy, and the love represented by the birth in Bethlehem this night fill our lives and become part of all that we say and do. May we share the divine life of your Son, Jesus Christ, even as he humbled himself to share our humanity. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Joy to the World, hymn number 267. May the Lord bless you.
Celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. Have a happy holiday season.